brought to you by Penguin. Race and Education. Written and read by me, Kalwant Bhopal. Please note that this book contains occasional words and phrases that might be triggering for some listeners. Introduction. In this book, I want to explore how race affects the educational experience of ethnic minority groups in Britain by analysing how institutions and processes work to perpetuate racism in education. In the pages that follow, I work from the premise that racism is a given in society and is central to explaining how education reinforces systems and structures of whiteness and white privilege that benefit white people. I specifically focus on schools and higher education institutions in the UK and examine how the impact of white policymaking perpetuates white supremacy in this country. Drawing on my own empirical data and that of others, I use research on schools and universities in Britain to show how this inequality works in practice. For the past 30 years, I have devoted my academic career to researching and writing about education and racism, an undertaking that's had its genesis in my own experiences of racism in Britain, and the ways in which it has intertwined with my personal and academic life. My parents emigrated to England from India in the 1950s, and I was the first child in my family to be born in the UK. I grew up watching Coronation Street and eating fish and chips every Friday night. But from an early age, I experienced racism and never felt completely accepted by white British society. It started with my parents. I vividly remember my father getting stopped and questioned by the police on a regular basis because he drove an expensive car, as if to suggest that Asian people could not afford to own such vehicles or indeed be allowed to drive them. At primary school, I was already viewed as an outsider and was often taunted by my classmates with slurs such as, "You smell of curry, you packy." As a teenager, the racism continued, and I even remember crossing a busy street on one occasion and being shouted at by a white policeman in a police car, "Get out of the road, you packy." My encounters with racism have followed me into adulthood, and I have lost count of the number of times I've been asked, "Where are you from?" When I respond with London, I'm inevitably asked again, "No, where are you really from?" I have been told, "You must be used to the hot weather where you come from, and that I don't need sunscreen because, of course, brown skin doesn't burn." More bizarrely, I've been complimented by random strangers who've told me, "Your English is so good." I've also been ignored and sometimes encountered overt hostility in shops, bars, and restaurants where white people are greeted warmly and politely. None of these are one-off or unusual examples. They are regular, everyday occurrences. My name has been shortened to Cal without my consent. I've been asked if it's okay to call me Carol because Kalwant is too difficult to say or spell. As someone from an ethnic minority, I encounter covert and overt racism every single day of my life. Having been deeply affected by racism, I decided to enter academia as a career, naively thinking it would be a safe haven, inclusive and tolerant. How wrong I was. I have experienced both overt and covert racism throughout my academic career. I was racially bullied in one organisation for 5 years, and this has had a profound effect on me. I found myself not only questioning my right to belong in the white space of higher education, but even the validity of my scholarship. I was made to feel like an outsider by other white academics. My research on racism was denigrated by my peers and not seen as worthy. In meetings, fellow academics would avoid eye contact with me and my views were dismissed. Publicly, my research was often excluded from seminars and conferences. I was constantly reminded that higher education was a white space reserved for whites only. I ultimately left the university in question, but instead of giving up, The experience made me determined to show how racism continues to persist in all aspects of our lives, including in higher education. This was one of the reasons I decided to then focus my research on racial discrimination in education. I wanted to understand how schools and universities were complicit in perpetuating racism and how it could be challenged and addressed. In this book, I work from the premise that racism is a commonplace feature of everyday life. Determining how ethnic minority groups are treated, I aim to show how schools and higher education establishments implicitly perpetuate racism and disadvantage ethnic minority groups in the UK, whilst at the same time benefiting white people by perpetuating whiteness and white privilege. Because of its vital influence on individual life chances and choices, education provides a key lens through which we can view the workings of racism and racist practices. Educational success is a crucial indicator of social mobility, access to the labour market, earning potential, and one's likely position in society. Those who succeed in education hold the keys to status and power. They are more likely to pursue careers that have a significant impact on society, owing to their influence in the media, politics, or the law. By the same token, those who do not succeed in the education system are less likely to have their views heard or their interests addressed. Without a proper insight into the educational experience of different groups, therefore, we cannot gain a true understanding of the workings and inequalities of the society in which we live. The main focus of this book is an examination of the experiences of ethnic minorities within the British education system. But before we explore this, it's worth saying a few words about who we mean when we talk about ethnic minorities. There have been several attempts in academia and elsewhere to try to group them under one label, with BME, Black and Minority Ethnic, or BAME, Black, Asian and Minority Ethnic, being the main terms in current use. Other alternatives include people of colour, global majority, and minoritised communities, terms that are more popular in the United States. Neither of these terms appeal to me because they are not sufficiently inclusive. BME prioritises the experiences of Black groups, and BAME prioritises those of Black and Asian groups. They also homogenise the experiences of a diverse range of people and disregard the disparities and diversities that exist within and between these different groups. Furthermore, these labels do not necessarily use Black as a political term that encompasses all people of colour, including those from Indian, Pakistani, and Bangladeshi backgrounds, who continue to encounter racial discrimination and have historically suffered under colonialism and imperialism. Using Black as an all-encompassing political term could be a move towards a united fight against racism. In the 1970s, it was used in anti-racist campaigns by Caribbean, African, Arab, and Asian communities to express a united front in their common struggles against racism. This worked to strengthen a politics of solidarity between the different groups to challenge everyday racism in all areas of society, from employment and housing to the media, health, and education. Some have argued that the term Black does not include South Asian groups as it denies South Asian identity, while others have argued that many South Asians do not define themselves as Black, and many Black Africans and Black Caribbeans do not regard them as such either, as I was to discover for myself. It is important to remind ourselves that race itself is a social construct, and the terms Black and South Asian are fluid, essentialist, and intertwined in a range of diverse social, economic, and historical interpretations. Moreover, their meaning can vary according to the context, whether social, cultural, or political. As a university undergraduate, my politics as an Asian woman were linked to the political term Black and the emergence of Black feminism in Britain, which acknowledged the importance of intersecting strands such as race and gender. However, my own identity as a black woman was questioned. When I was a first-year undergraduate, my presence in the Black Student Society was queried by a black Caribbean man who said I should not be part of the group.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.